Very much admirable and Firebat. Welcome back to the Caster Desk. My name is Cora, and I'm joined by the only caster that gives me hair envy. It is Sottle. Although I guess Dan sort of fits into that category, too.
Just in a different way, though. His hair is just glorious. Mine just goes for pure length.
Well, some of us aren't quite so lucky. But going into this next match, it is going to be Frozen versus Silent Storm. And I'll tell you what, Sottle, we are lucky because I think this match is the one that I'm the most excited about.
Yeah, I mean, there are 9 other decks in this matchup, but there is really only one that matters, and that's, you know, not just exaggerating the point. It's just when you bring a strategy this linear, when you bring a deck that is built in the way that Frozen's Priest deck is, double Mind Control, double Entomb, double Shadow of Death.
Sideshow Spell Eater
Justicar. This is a deck that, by Frozen's own confession, cannot win a game of Hearthstone unless it beats Warrior. I got this information from Firebat, but he says he spoke to Frozen, and he says the second best matchup for the deck is Midrange Shaman. Sounds great,
that's
right?
Pretty good.
It's 20%.
That's pretty bad.
Yeah.
It's not great.
So
it's not what you're hoping for.
Straight away, Frozen, like the rest of his decks, to be clear, are also targeting Warrior. He has a greedy mid-range hunter with N'Zoth in it as well. Smashes Warrior, tears it to the ground. N'Zoth Paladin, same thing, beats up Warrior. N'Zoth Reno Lock, the same thing. His weakest matchup against Warrior is the Mirror, the Warrior Mirror. So Frozen here has led out the Warrior here. If he can get this deck out of the way, then the target Warrior strategy is on. But as the guys on the analyst desk were pointing out, this is a C'Thun Warrior.
Mm-hmm.
This is something that plays some 4-2 Divine Shield minions that can just beat up Priest on their own. It can just C'Thun you 3 times for 20 damage each and you're dead. Like, these things can just happen. I'm scared for Priest, Cora. I just am.
It's gonna be a tough road, but I'll tell you what, if Frozen can make this work, then I can't even imagine the amount of respect he will gain. I mean, he's already garnered an incredible amount of respect for having the guts to bring this lineup, but if it works out, he's just a genius.
Yeah, and straight away, you can see the level of high risk, high reward that Frozen is willing to go for here. Goes for the Tinkmaster Overspark right off the bat, which, by the way, is a tech in a lot of his decks, again, to help deal with Warriors. The two primary Warriors you're going to face against, N'Zoth Warrior and C'Thun Warrior, fantastic decks to Tinkmaster things against. So his deck is very, very much tech that way. But straight away, straight off the bat, he just played it on a board with a couple of early game minions that could have been just turned into 5/5s and lost him the game. He did get the squirrel, so he's in a reasonable position here, but Silent Storm with the mid-range Shaman matchup here, if he's patient, if he can space out his threats, if he can hold on to Thunderbluff Valiance until after Brawls, then he's going to be still in a strong spot to be able to push through.
Frozen's entire strategy is very high risk, high reward.
Yes.
And going into this opening hand, it was rather weak. He's got some cycle, he's got Brawl, which will come in very handy, but no Fiery War Axe, no early removal. So that Tinkmaster Overspark was really his only way to sort of stay in this game and provide some early pressure. So it worked out very well for him. And now going into the later turns, he's definitely going to have a better chance at winning this match. But the mid-range Shaman versus Warrior matchup, I feel like, is very split right now. That mid-range Shaman can put down so much pressure on board, and if the Warrior doesn't have that AoE removal, then the Shaman can just quickly take the game.
Yeah, it really hinges on the amount of board leverage win conditions that you're playing as the Shaman. If you're playing double Bloodlust Thunderbluff Valiant, for example, if you're playing all the board leverage things, then that's a really big deal and can help you get through. But looking at Silent Storm's list, he is only playing the 2 Thunderbluff Valiants, so there is the chance for a competent Control Warrior player to just exhaust the threats of the Shaman deck. But having seen one Brawl being forced to be used as early as turn 5, that's a huge win for the Shaman. No matter what minions survive there, the fact that one of those Brawls is notched off the mental checklist, that's so huge, because there is still 2 Thunderbluff boards in Frozen's future now that need to be dealt with.
I mean, Frozen's going to have other ways to remove. He does have weapons in the deck.
Yep.
He's got more minion quality than the average Control Warrior does. You can see those Ancient Shield Bearers in hand. So he's likely going to want to remove at least one of the Thunderbluff boards with minion pressure, but that's going to be difficult considering going into turn 6, all he has to play right now is shield blocks.
Yeah, you're just, again, and against Shaman in particular, they're the best snowball class in the board, in the game. The best board control class in the game. Also one of the best aggressive classes in the game. They just have
one of the best.
They just have a lot of things going for them. So if your plan is get some minions on the board and fight that way, that's just not a plan you can consistently rely on. So these brawls are your catch-all answer to those kind of aggressive board states that they will generate. So again, the fact that one of them has already gone is such a huge win for Silent Storm.
Now, but assuming that Silent Storm does have some trouble building up a board, which is, it's not looking like he's going to. He's got some nice minion pressure in hand, and he's got some cycle. But those Lightning Storms, for instance, may not be great in this matchup. So if he does have some trouble, then Frozen can capitalize with cards like the Ancient Shield Bearer to build his health back up and start to fight back.
Thunderbluff number 3 off the Barnes, though, is a huge deal. That creates an insane amount of pressure, and it's essentially a free Thunderbluff. In terms of threat rationing in this matchup, Thunderbluffs are your biggest tools. Timing those perfectly is key to winning this matchup as the mid-range shaman. The fact that he just gets one for free there off the Barnes eats up a fiery war axe charge, gets to push some damage with some totems, and actually just retains power in play even after Frozen's removal turn with the 2-2 healing totem as well.
Yeah, the only really thing that would have been better from the Barnes there would have been the Ragnaros, the Fire Lord, that is at the very top end of Silent Storm's deck. But Manitai totems are good, Azure Drakes for spell damage are good, and in this case, Thunderbluff Valiant is excellent.
You can see Silent Storm kind of played to that out as well. He had the opportunity to develop Barnes on 4 on a favorable board state. I think it was an empty board on the other side. But again, there are a lot of decks that kind of go with this strategy of putting minions in your deck that leverage having excess mana available when you play Barnes. And you know, Silent Storm recognized that he hadn't drawn a Thunderbluff yet, so he had decent odds of picking up a Thunderbluff, played for it perfectly on curve on turn 6, hit it, and it was a huge advantage for him.
Barnes has been really contentious, actually, thus far in competitive play. Sometimes it's fantastic, sometimes you just whiff and you get a 4-5 for 4 of stats, but it's spread out, so it's not effective. But so far today, we've seen Barnes bring out a Gadgets and Auctioneer for a Rogue class, and now the Thunderbluff Valiant for the Shaman is looking very strong.
Yeah, and just look at this board, right? One brawl gone. Look at this board. It demands brawl number 2 straight away. And even if brawl number 2 comes out, most of the time you still retain a minion, be it just a 2-3 or a 2-2 healing totem or whatever survives. And then your refill is just Azure Drake thing from below the turn after that. There's just so much pressure going through here. With that one brawl out the window already, no second brawl in hand, Frozen can gain some life, but if he can't address the board, all that life that he gains just gets immediately chewed through by the existing board state.
And Silent Storm here might even want to invest his AoE board clears. It will not remove a huge board, but even 2 minions against a warrior is sufficient for a board clear.
Yep. Sure is. They are terrible cards in the matchup. Really hard to get value out of. And he has 3 of them in his hand with the 2 Lightning Storms and the 1 Portal. No surprise to see him use one. He went for the spell damage pull off the totem roll there, as opposed to just using 2 AoE effects. Didn't hit it. He's had that Spirit Claws kind of locked in his hand the entire game. But it looks like he may just be holding onto it to play around the Harrison Jones that we can see that Frozen has in his deck here, just not wanting to give Frozen any outs to stop what is looking like a fairly comfortable game for Silent Storm right now.
Second brawl comes out, and Barnes still surviving on board, giving Silent Storm even more damage that he can throw at face on this turn. Frozen does have still some more health gain, but with both brawls gone, he really doesn't have any means of clearing the board other than maybe Bran Bronzebeard plus Ravaging Ghoul.
Yeah, Bran Ravaging Ghoul is an out. C'Thun is an out, just slamming it and clearing the board, and that might honestly be his biggest win condition at this point, which is draw C'Thun, slam C'Thun, hope it sticks, leverage from there. But he's going to go up to 14 here with the Drake for the extra spell damage, the Spirit Claw, and the Lightning Bolt. That is going to be an incredibly comfortable game one performance from Silent Storm.
All right, and Silent Storm just really showing off the absolute power of the mid-range Shaman. Even with the loss of the Tuskar Totemic in a lot of cases, it is still just very dominant in this meta, and what looked like an easy win for him against Frozen.
Yeah, there's been a lot of debate as to how you react to Tuskar Totemic disappearing. A lot of people have started playing Argent Horse Rider in that spot, very powerful in the mirror, for example, because you can take out each other's spell damage totems before them actually getting any leverage. But Silent Storm has just said, hey, you know what? I don't really need extra three drops. I'm just going to play other good cards like Ragnaros and Fire Elementals and things like that. Shaman has an amazing toolbox available to them. So even with the loss of the Tuskar Totemic, they've reacted brilliantly. Great game one from Silent Storm. Pulled out the Brawls, developed afterwards. Too much pressure for the Warrior. Textbook play of that matchup.
Yep, Silent Storm taking game number one, and we're going to get right into game number two. So don't go anywhere. We'll be back right after this. Quarterfinal number three between Frozen and Silent Storm is underway here at the America's Last Call Invitational. Silent Storm, of course, just won the matchup of Midrange Shaman versus C'Thun Warrior. So he's gone up to a quick 1-0 over Frozen. Frozen with the most unique deck lineup I think I've seen at any HCT tournament thus far.
Yeah, I mean, Frodan earlier during his cast was explaining, you know, the levels of strategy that come into Conquest, and this is that strategy where you target a particular deck in your opponent's lineup and you try and force it out of the series. They have to win with every deck, so if you can prevent one deck from winning, you win the series. But this is that strategy extended to either genius or madness, one of the two. We will find out which, but the thing is, to bring this strategy to a tournament of this high stakes and with this level of discrepancy between first and second is insane, in my opinion, because it doesn't matter. Like, you could get a lineup like this where you expect 90% of people to bring Control Warrior, and you get yourself a really solid position in the tournament very consistently. Your EV is very high.
And if that last person doesn't have it, then it literally does not matter.
Then all your work, not just in this one tournament, but all your work for the entire year means nothing because one person didn't bring Control Warrior. That is absurd, in my opinion. We will see if it's going to work out for Frozen. But before we get to that priest, he has a lot of other decks that he needs to march through. This greedy Justicar Trueheart N'Zoth Paladin. If there is anything that beats up on Control Warrior as well as the priest deck that Frozen has built does, Justicar Trueheart in Paladin, that'll get him done.
I haven't seen that since, goodness, Quartermaster rotated out. I mean, back then, the Justicar in the Paladin was a little bit common. It was something you would see because it does target the Warrior matchup very well. But nowadays, it is just unheard of. So seeing how it's going to play out, I don't think in this matchup it's going to be very effective, but I think the N'Zoth Paladin still has a decent shot.
This Soulfire is getting cast every single time this turn, right? Like, letting that Doomsayer go off is a big, big detriment to you, and it's a Soulfire that has 1 in 4 upside as well as, you know, potential downside of discarding a minion here. So I would be stunned if he's not going for the Soulfire, doubly so now that he's already committed the Peddler. And the difference here between a Silverware Golem and any other card is enormous!
Oh my goodness.
And that is just how you play Zoo these days. That might sound like I'm kind of like mocking the play, mocking the deck, but you have to understand your percentages when you play this deck. And sometimes if that option is presented to you, you would be a fool not to go for it.
Well, because nowadays, Zoo has really no means of getting back onto the board if it loses board early on, which is what the Paladin can do. It can very easily clear board and attempt to take control of the game. So if the Zoo doesn't get that early control, then they will likely just not win the matchup. So in this case, a lot of the time, if you Soulfire, then you will just win.
Spoiler alert! Whoa!
We don't actually know if that's the case. I would say that somebody backstage is making some bold predictions.
We promise you this is not pre-recorded. If you cut back to us, we will both put our shoes on our head.
Oh, man, I'm wearing a heel.
Oh, okay, we won't.
It's gonna
hurt. Definitely won't. That is an
empty
promise. Don't call me on that. Okay, sure. But going back to the game, this was actually a very, very good snap call from Frozen to make the Pyromancer coin Forbidden Healing play, contest the board perfectly. It's essentially a full clear with one of his Pyromancers. He can feel relatively confident that these 2-3-1s trade with each other. So, you know, one Pyromancer down, one board clear achieved. That's reasonably solid for Frozen at this point.
Yeah, it's not bad, but then going into the next couple of turns, he doesn't have anything strong to play at this point. You don't want to expend your second Pyromancer early on because it does have such combo potential with cards like Equality, which will be very necessary in this matchup. So on turn four, just a Hero Power against a 2-5 Imp Gang boss?
Yeah.
It feels pretty bad.
Definitely doesn't feel great. Would have loved True Silver that turn. Doomsayer number two would have been beautiful, but... yeah, he's going to have to fill some gaps, essentially, until he can get into his Ken, Emperor, Justicar, those kind of tools. Yeah, Justicar actually a reasonable tool to have against Zoo as well. If you can get that one free turn to develop the Justicar, then this is a deck where you will whiff on some mana quite often. So you will be forced to press Hero Power quite often. And if you are doubling the efficacy of your Hero Power against Zoo, that's actually a really big deal if you can find the time to play it as well. But for now, he needs to find some turns. He needs his deck to be kind to him here in terms of giving him answers. Otherwise, you know, it might just be looking at something as miserable as just consecrating this board to take care of at least the three minions on the right-hand side. And now with that Blood Imp buff, he cannot even do that.
That is just so unfortunate. Blood Imp, we have not seen in Zoo in a very long time. We saw Young Priestess earlier today, and usually if you're playing Dark Peddler, Blood Imp is sort of the thing that you just don't even acknowledge. It's usually never as good as the other options, but in this case, putting that Imp Gang boss at a 5 health total, bumping that Voidwalker out of the way is just so, so good right now. So essentially, if Frozen plays the Consecration, which he can't, he already Hero Powered, it would only be removing 2 power off board, plus the 2 from the adjacent minions that the Direwolf Alpha then buffs, of course.
Yeah, that Blood Imp is a mighty fine Hearthstone player, actually. In consecutive turns, the Blood Imp has played around True Silver and Consecration from the Paladin. Like, he knows the matchup.
Smart.
He knows the matchup.
So Frozen has chosen to Hero Power once again, and that Doomsayer at this point will just be killed. But it's essentially saving him 7 life right now, so it's sort of what he's forced into.
Yeah, but the pressure plays keep on coming here from Silent Storm. Remember, from Silent Storm's perspective, he has seen 1 Pyromancer used already, and he's also seen 3 cards on the left-hand side of Frozen's hand that have not even been thought about play. They've just sat there dead the entire time. So he'll be looking at Frozen's hand and thinking, you know, things like the 6 drops, like Tyrion, potentially a second Forbidden Healing as another option. Although I think there's only 1 in Frozen's deck. In fact, there is. Yeah. So the amount of dead cards that can potentially be sat in that hand the whole time are pretty low, because even things like Harrison Jones would have been played out. He probably would have just cycled Solemn Vigil by now. So he could actually have a pretty strong read on some of those cards on the left-hand side by process of elimination.
Yeah, and at this point, it's really either heavy minions or perhaps the Equality that he didn't have a chance to pair with another card in his hand.
Sure.
And then going into turn number 6, Frozen also has a Youthful Brewmaster in his deck that I want to highlight very quickly. Not bad, actually. Works well with the Aldar Peacekeeper if you're playing against a control deck that has 2 large attack minions, or Spellbreaker is really the only silence in the game right now, and if you can get 2 silences, it's not bad.
His plan, again, this is a 100% polarized anti-warrior lineup. So his plan here for that Brewmaster is to Emperor, Brewmaster, and Nazoth in his hand, and then play Nazoth, Brewmaster his Nazoth back to his hand for 10 mana, get himself a Tyrion and a Cairn on the board, and then if it gets dealt with, just do it all over again. This deck just doesn't lose to Warrior. But there are other decks in this tournament that you have to beat.
You, in fact, have to bring 5 decks if you want to enter this tournament.
Sometimes one of them isn't Control Warrior. Sometimes it's Pirate Warrior.
As crazy as that sounds, we saw Nostum bring that aggro Pirate Warrior. Yep. Dragon Warrior is still a deck. Can confirm, still a deck. So the Brewmaster in this case, like I said, not great. Aldor is something, Spellbreaker's something, but at this point you're not going to have the chance, really. So Silent Storm is just easily going to clear off that Tharizan, put a Silverware Golem out, and draw a card.
Oh, baby. That draws the Darkshire Librarian as well, so he has more additional discard synergy now if he wants it, but we'll probably just be playing this out with an empty hand and tapping afterwards. But he is building up an enormous board presence right now. Pyromancer Consecration does some work, actually significant work now because of the full board. Although minions will be cleared before the Pyromancer proc. But still, those Imp Gang bosses operating on a full board now means that the AoE options are increased from Frozen. So maybe a little bit of a hiccup here from Silent Storm, but the way his turn played out, he was going to discard that Silverware Golem, so there was no way he could really play around that and stop that being summoned. So in the end, it's a reasonable outcome, but as you can see, the Pyromancer proc will still spawn the additional minions off the Imgang boss first because of the way the sequencing works. So not the end of the world just yet for Silent Storm, but still gave his opponent some opportunities there with the full board.
And I mean, you've seen so many turns where the equality has not come out. You've had a safe board for about three turns now, so you can't really play around something like this, especially when you've seen that first Wild Pyromancer already. So Silent Storm's board is still not in a bad state, and now Frozen is out of board clear. But going into the later turns, Ragnaros the Light Lord heals for eight. He's got the Cairn Bloodhoof in hand, which a little slow right now, but it is what he has to combo with in Azoth at this point. So it's not actually looking too bad for Frozen.
Silent Storm, just considering his options here, decides not to take the extra plus one buff on the Darkshire Councilman by trading in the Imgang boss, just decides to buff up both of the Imgang bosses with the Argus instead. And now, as you said, Ragnaros the Light Lord, just the most powerful play that Frozen can make on this turn, but two Pyromancers and a Consecration used. So even if Equality were to be drawn at this point, which, again, talking about Silent Storm's reads, he can probably rule out at this point that Equality is not in the hand based on the plays he's seen. So from his perspective, even if an Equality is to have been drawn from the deck over the last couple of turns, it needs to be paired with exactly one remaining Consecration. That's the only out in the deck in terms of board clear.
Yeah, and just very unlikely, as far as from Silent Storm's perspective, that Frozen has those cards in hand, because strictly he has not used them yet. So Silent Storm, obviously that Light Lord is a threat, but when you've got this much damage on board and there's no board clear, you're dealing more than eight per turn.
So now the decision is, okay, Silent Storm is just going face. So he can choose to lose three damage here to play around a 50% chance of his opponent not gaining eight, right? So essentially it's three damage versus four, half of the eight heal. So it's not as cut and dry as you may think here. Trading in the Imgang boss actually buffs him up an extra point of damage on the Darkshire Councilman as well. And his other option is just to clean trade just like this. This is the option I was going to end up winding to. Sets himself up with lethal anyway, plays around any possible heals. You're looking at specifically Tyrion from your opponent probably at this point to be able to wall you out of the game. And now with the infested Tauren coming down, just the Flame Imp takes care of that. And there is in fact just lethal on the board. The Doomguard doesn't need to be shown.
And Silent Storm taking another quick game. He's gone up 2-0 very fast against Frozen. That Azoth Paladin struggling in the early game, even with Doomsayer and early Wild Pyromancer, but just too heavy for these matchups. Really, at this rate, targeting that Control Warrior is the only way he's going to come back into the series.
It's the only way he was ever going to win the series. That's the thing, right?
Like, you get a little lucky.
We don't want to devalue the rest of the series, but when your lineup is so polarized as Frozen's is, there is literally only one win. There's a thing in Conquest where there are unimportant wins and there are important wins. And any non-Warrior deck in Silent Storm's lineup, when it wins, it is unimportant. The Warrior has to win. That is the story of this series.
He just assumed that those decks would get wins, and well, they are. So yeah. I mean, at the same time, Silent Storm knows this strategy, but he has to feel fairly good about getting those wins so handily, even though you know you're going to get them. Yeah. It's still a morale boost.
Yeah, I mean, it just doesn't matter. I mean, he's set up to win every series 4-3 if he needs to, because even if these decks had not won already, they will beat his priest by the time that it comes time for him to have to pick up a win with his priest. So these are unimportant victories for Silent Storm. This is all on the line with his warrior. And I'm scared because I can see so many win conditions.
I mean,
for the C'Thun Warrior in that matchup specifically, what Silent Storm needs to have done, though, is to have gone away and played 100 games against a good player playing Frozen's exact list. Because if he tries to play that matchup as just C'Thun Warrior versus a regular Control Priest deck, he will lose.
Yes.
That is not the same matchup at all. So he needs to know what he's doing specifically against this insane, nonsense, bananas priest that Frozen has brought with him.
And even assuming that the priest gets a win, Reno Lock can be very inconsistent as far as draws. If that draws poorly, the warrior can combat that. The N'Zoth Paladin, which we're seeing here, is very good in the warrior matchup, but you know, crazy things can happen and crazier things have happened. You know, particularly the fact that a priest was brought in the first place is crazy.
And this is another unpleasant looking start for Frozen. Silent Storm just has all the ramp that he wants in the world right now. Two innovates, two Maya Keepers. He can choose to curve this out however he would like. His druid in particular is a Malagos druid, which this matchup, in my opinion, hugely favorable for the Malagos druid. You can draw your deck, you can put on enough pressure, you can eat through their heals quite comfortably, and you just get it done. You just, you know, quite often just Malagos plus Moonfire and one Living Roots at the end of the game is enough to back up all the pressure that you've had through, pull out their equalities with like one Arcane Giant or a Ragnaros at a time, and then just still be able to finish the job with the Malagos burst. It's a really hard win for the N'Zoth Paladin to pick up.
Specifically, Frozen is only playing one copy of Forbidden Healing.
Yep.
So the early minion damage that Silent Storm gets down will likely be negated by that card. The True Silver Champion here and there can get a little bit of healing, as well as the Ragnaros Light Lord, of course. But at the end of the game, Silent Storm with Raven Idols and discounts with that Malagos can deal so much damage at one point, and it's just going to be very difficult for Frozen to combat that combo damage in the late game.
Yeah, so Silent Storm still considering whether to just play it really slow here. He didn't snap innovate the Maya Keeper there. He was tempted to just even wait and just go coin Maya Keeper into potentially Maya Keeper or Azir Drake the turn after. Does choose to use the innovate in the end, so now he can curve perfectly into his second Maya Keeper and hold on to his coin and innovate here if he needs to make any bigger plays later on. And Frozen is just stuck doing control paladin things for now, pressing hero power pass. And Silent Storm, in the meantime, getting a huge mana advantage for himself.
You know, I really like keeping the ramp because, as we were sort of saying, in the later game that Malagos has so much combo potential,
yep.
But Malagos is a 9-mana card. It's very expensive. So a lot of the time you want to have that innervate, the coin, if you can even afford to keep it left in your hand, to be able to combine with Living Roots, with a swipe if you have that liberty, can be fantastic with the Malagos. So here he's literally just giving himself more options in the future when he knows that he's going to be so ahead in the early game anyway.
Yeah, it's worth noting that Silent Storm doesn't play Emperor in his list, which changes the dynamic significantly. It does reduce your total burst damage, which again gives you some merit to, you know, if you've got an innovate in your hand at the end of the game, it's not dead. It ups your amount of damage that you can do with Malagos. That does change the dynamic a little bit because Frozen will be able to somewhat calculate the max damage burst in terms of, you know, real mana constraints on Emperored conditions. So that does change the dynamic a little bit, and Frozen might have a survival win condition here. But, you know, for the foreseeable future, he's just going to be fighting from behind on the board from now, taking a little bit of chip damage, just getting beaten up, leaving a few battle scars. That means that he'll be potentially in range of a burst combination anyway.
So going into turn number four, he's in a better position than the last game because he has something to play, which is very nice for him.
It is.
He's going to be able to clear up these Mire Keepers with the True Silver, but Silent Storm is going to keep the pressure coming. And that Azure Drake, also a target for the True Silver, but ultimately you have to pick one unless you want to use other methods of removal. So actually here, I could see the Innervate Ragnaros, which is what he's actually going to do.
It's 8 damage to face, and it forces an equality from your opponent. There are no Keeper of Alderman in Frozen's list, so no way to take care of this Ragnaros just using the True Silver Champion that you have. So you are demanding an equality from your opponent, but the Spanner in the works, or potentially the Squirrel in the works here for Frozen, is the Tinkmaster. This is huge. That's a 1-1.
Squirrel. That makes Tinkmaster Overspark look like a card we should have been using this whole time.
Yeah. Isn't it glorious that we commentate a video game where you get to shout, "That's a squirrel!"
I mean, I do that pretty much in my everyday life.
Yeah.
Around my college campus, it's squirrels for days. And you can't out loud shout, "That's a squirrel." But in my head, every time I pass one on that, I mean, they're still really cute. And I mean, this is adorable on board. Silent Storm, I'm sure, is not as happy about it as I would be seeing that squirrel in every day, and as Frozen is right now seeing it on his board. So essentially, that allowed Frozen to keep the equality and swing the board a little bit with a 3-3.
Sure did, and this 1-1 squirrel is just gonna peck away. It's still pushing through the damage. You know, one is a number, believe it or not. It's not five, but it's a number. It helps. It pushes him into range of that Malagos burst combo that can come out. And Frozen here, on the turn he intended to play Barnes, did not want to draw his Tyrion Fordring.
One is the loneliest number, but it's not zero here, which is all that Silent Storm can really bank on. And Frozen is going to take out that squirrel. I'm not sure which one's cuter, that or Murloc Tinyfin. Which one do you feel worse about when it leaves the board?
I mean, you just feel like the worst kind of person whenever you kill a tiny fin. Not that I'm advocating murdering squirrels either, let's make that clear. But
I mean, I would hope not. The British are, they're a little dry, but I don't see them as squirrel killers.
No.
I mean, I could be wrong. I've never visited your country.
It's horrible. Just don't bother.
All right. Good to know.
So, Swipe Moonglade Portal is an available play here for Silent Storm. If he does want to give up his Innovate, it looks like he is just going to go ahead and swipe the face here. So it's not going to be the Moonglade Portal play, I don't think. It's just going to Hero Power down
Soddle.
The 2-1 and push face. Yes.
That is a coin and a Moonfire. I do not see an Innovate in hand.
Oh, my bad. Okay, sorry. I was just looking at zero mana cards in a seat. I thought the Moonfire was Innovate. Thank you, Cora.
No problem, Soddle.
Glad
you got me
covered.
It's my one moment where sitting next to you, I'm going to feel intelligent. So I'm going to hold on to that one, and I'm going to let it boost me through the rest of the series.
There you go. Take it to the bank.
Absolutely. All right, turn number 7. Frozen still cannot play that Tyrion, but he does have options. Barnes coming out at this point can still pull quite a few nice cards. Rag Lightlord, Sylvanas would be really nice.
Yeah, Rag Lightlord would be huge in this position because he is just dying. I mean, just the threat of the Drake on board that's kind of a struggle to deal with right now unless he wants to throw out a Consecration or an Equality. And the combination of that plus potentially Living Roots or just Moonfire plus some other potential damage. So yeah, it's just going to have to Equality an Azure Drake here. Drops the Barnes to follow it up. Again, Rag Lightlord would be massive for Frozen here. That is a Doomsayer!
Okay, yeah, it's terrible.
It's just not good.
It's really bad.
There's always a temptation to say, well, this is okay because it's Silent Storm can do this, but that's the point. You give the option to your opponent every single time, right? Like when it's a 1-1 Doomsayer, they can kill it if they want to, and if they decide that they don't want to kill it, then they just don't kill it. It's never really a thing that has an upside for you when it happens, but looks like Moonglade, Portal, and Hero Power is the obvious line. Silent Storm is considering some Arcane Giant trickery here. He could coin first to get himself to 10 mana, Arcane Giant for 8 mana, and then Hero Power down the 1-1. That works perfectly fine, too. Oh! You just outplayed yourself, Silent Storm.
That sucks. Void Crusher, not a card you generally see because it's terrible. In this case, if Silent Storm Hero powers, it has the Inspire effect, destroy a random minion for each player, and it will destroy the Void Crusher.
Yes, it will. So he now has to Moonfire the 1-1 if he wants to retain that 5-4 on the board. Roping right now. He needs to make a decision.
And he didn't.
Okay.
And now the entire board is gone because of the Doomsayer. So Frozen, Barnesing out the Doomsayer doesn't seem good, but it looks like Silent Storm was a little bit flustered there and made a mistake.
I mean, doing nothing was a legitimate decision,
yes,
right? Because hero powering is worse than doing nothing a lot of the time. If it kills itself and the Doomsayer, then your opponent just has a 3-4 on the board and you have nothing. So doing nothing is a legitimate play. That's not, you know, necessarily Silent Storm just roping out and missing the play. He just chose the do nothing option, but the big deal is the sequencing there with the Moonglade Portal and the Hero Power getting punished by Void Crusher.
It's not something that you really take into consideration. I mean, generally six drops are very good.
They are.
But
extremely strong.
Unfortunately here, that was, just didn't work out for him. All right, so two Arcane Giants off the back of the coin and that Wrath for Cycle here. Frozen.
Yeah, you just do it. Both Arcane Giants. There's a Tyrion on the board, so even if your opponent does have his one remaining Equality to take care of this, he's Equalitying his own Tyrion anyway, so there's a little bit of an upside for you on that anyway. Does have a little bit of burst from hand now with the Living Roots and the Moonfire. If he draws Malagos at any point, that combination is just lethal. So there is a triple-pronged threat here coming up Frozen. He's got the board, he's got the damage in hand, and he's got the potential draws that Frozen needs to deal with at this point.
Not gonna do it.
Wow.
Yeah, Frozen needed to pick up Equality Pyromancer off of the Solemn Vigil and unfortunately gets two unplayable cards. So that Paladin going to be dropping yet another game for Frozen. Silent Storm going up 3-0, but this is the position that Frozen knew he would find himself in. So now the C'Thun Warrior will be coming out from Silent Storm. And then Frozen has a long road ahead of him.
This is it. This is where the series starts. This is where we get to decide. Is it glory or misery? Is it genius or madness? Either way, whether this warrior can pick up a win now. Like, the series is just starting.
Starting now. All right. Well, glory and misery await these players. Who gets what? We'll find out right after this. Don't go anywhere. Quarterfinal number three began 3 games ago, but now it is really getting started. Silent Storm is left with just his C'Thun Warrior to win the series, and Frozen, with 4 decks built specifically to target this Warrior deck, has a long road ahead of him, Sottl.
Yeah. I will preface this whole statement by saying, when I say cannot win, I'm talking like 80% plus favored, right?
Okay.
But the Warrior cannot win against the Paladin. The Warrior cannot win against the Hunter. It's the other 3 decks where it potentially has a chance. And I'm putting the Priest deck into that, which might seem weird, considering that the Priest deck is obviously something that Frozen has like 100% confidence in that it beats Warrior. I haven't seen it play out enough to give it that stamp of approval, but it's the Reno Lock, it's the Mirror, and it's the Priest deck. That's where Silent Storm needs to be looking to pick up his wins, because he just can't do it against the other 2 decks.
Sottl, I am going to pose a hypothetical here. If Silent Storm wins this game, we will never see the Priest deck.
Wow. I just shed a single tear.
I just got very sad. Very, very sad. Anduin finally has a chance to have his day in the sun. Or Tron Day, I suppose. We don't actually know which one it might be. And, man, gotta be rooting for Frozen a little bit here.
You do. You would have to be a stone-hearted, cold man to be rooting for Silent Storm in this series, so... Let's go, Silent Storm! Get him!
Sottl, you rag on yourself so much, but I have seen you rap Nicki Minaj lyrics, and I just can't let Twitch chat think for a second more that you're as cold-hearted as you portray yourself.
So meanwhile, on the board, we have a Beckoner of Evil. The follow-up here from Silent Storm to maintain tempo can choose to go with a Bran Bronzebeard play. Basically, the 2 minions on the right-hand side of his hand, he can choose to load here with the advantageous position of the next turn in mind. So he can play Acolyte of Pain now and then hope to play Ghoul on the next turn to get him get his card draw rolling. Or he can go for Bran and try and get the double buff off a Disciple of C'Thun, and that way potentially clear out a minion that he's dropped to contest, as well as just get his 10-10 achievement unlocked straight away so that his C'Thun deck is active.
Yeah, you absolutely need to do that as quickly as you can. Obviously, against the Reno Lock, you're not going to be taking that much damage that quickly, so it's sort of in the back of your mind, but when you're playing C'Thun Warrior, it's always something you need to be conscious of.
Right. I honestly, like, I definitely would have taken as long on this turn as Silent Storm just did. I really don't know which of these upsides I favor, because, you know, making sure you keep resources in hand against a control Warlock is a very big deal. This isn't a matchup that's going to go to fatigue a lot of the time. It's not a matchup you're going to lose in fatigue as the Warrior deck, because the Reno deck will naturally draw cards anyway. So making sure you're high on resources is actually a big deal. And I guess Spellbreaker is another consideration that Silent Storm will have had knowing the lists. Like, which of your cards would you rather get coin Spellbreaker, the Bran or the Acolyte of Pain? It's really tough in this situation, right?
Absolutely. If you want to keep pace with the amount of cards in your hand, that Acolyte of Pain is so key here, because it is literally your only cycle in the hand. So Bran Bronzebeard, not nearly as important. Obviously, Bran Doomcaller, Bran Ancient Shieldbearer is very nice, maybe, but that's a long way off.
Yep.
So here he's valuing card draw much higher, and you have to remove this Spellbreaker. Obviously, you know, AoE removal is a possibility, but man, Frozen's hand is just so heavy.
It is. It's really, really heavy and really clunky right now, but it's not the worst hand in the world to have against Control Warrior, honestly. Just a big old pile of your late game threats. Like, that's fine. You can start picking up some tools to load up that N'Zoth on a later date, then that's big. I mean, that right there will do just
that's
fine.
That's a great pickup for Frozen. All right.
Well, yeah.
Less great.
Yeah.
It's nice to see him join the party.
It is. that, you know, he's not going to have a huge impact on this game as a 1-1. He can definitely have a huge impact on this game as an alternate hero, but that is some way down the line. Double Fiery War Axe now picked up for Silent Storm, which alongside the Disciple of C'Thun or the Ravaging Ghoul can definitely start to make quick work of this board state now. But suddenly having drawn that, you know, just something as simple as that one Barnes to bridge the gap now, suddenly this heavier hand from Frozen is starting to look more appealing, right? Because he can curve through his hand. He's going to have 5 mana Mountain Giant next turn that he can play out into Emperor Thorasan. Mm-hmm. Suddenly he's got good potential to just start beating up on this warrior now.
Once Frozen gets into the later mana turns, he's going to have a lot more options. And especially going into the very late game, like you said, Lord Draxxus, not great as a 1-1, but as an alternate hero, can really be the driving force behind the Reno Lock in the late game versus the Warrior. Yep. With Nuzoth, the Warrior will usually brawl it off the board, should be able to clean that up. But Draxxus, his hero power, summoning the 6-6 Infernals, is so very difficult for the Warrior to deal with.
I love this aggression from Silent Storm. He is recognizing he's unfavored in this matchup. And when people talk about decks being unfavored in the classical sense in matchups, the first consideration that's being given to that is this deck loses more often than it wins if it's played in the manner that we are used to, right? A lot of people have these ideas on matchups where they don't really fully understand the range of strategies that you can put into it. Silent Storm here flicking the switch and saying, hey, I don't beat this youthful brewmaster Nuzoth Reno Warlock in the long game. I'm going to have to be the aggro deck here as much as my control warrior deck allows me to do that. I don't think it's going to pay out for him this game. I think Frozen's hand is just too good at the moment. But I love the recognition of that being the strategy that he needs to go for.
And it's absolutely just Silent Storm showing how many hours of this matchup he's played, how familiar he is with these decks. Frozen obviously comes in as the person who's been on more of a hot streak as of late, but Silent Storm is no joke. First place at the ESL Legendary Series and 7 consecutive top 30 ladder finishes. He is a fantastic player as well.
That is a big deal indeed. And yeah, Silent Storm here, I think, just committed to the line. He's just going to push face. We'll see him armor up here and potentially not even develop the second Fiery War Axe because of the threat of Acidic Ooze. Yes, indeed, he's going to hold on to it. So now Frozen forced into defensive lines for a little while here. He's going to have to play a little bit timidly in order to not just get run out of this game in terms of damage, but his hand's fine for doing that. He has 2 massive Taunt Givers in his hand with the Argus and the Sun Fury. That Peddler being picked up, not too relevant. So the trade here will happen on the Bran. I'm sure this 9 damage goes face, though. I can't imagine a world where this 9-9 gets sent into a 2-1.
The Disciple just not threatening here for Frozen.
Wow, he did it! Wow!
Or maybe it is very threatening. And you know what? That's not bad. It makes Brawl a little bit less good for Silent Storm. It does also damage the Mountain Giant, however, meaning that Execute wouldn't require an Activator this turn. So Frozen just playing it very safe. He's only at 8 health, and there is no Reno in hand. So that likely has a lot to do with it.
Yeah, there's a risk-reward tree going through Silent Storm's head right now because he can armor up, shield slam the Mountain Giant and just Fiery War Axe it down. That's, you know, a line he can take that gets rid of the 9-7 always. It's just not a pretty situation for him to have to do all that. Whereas the Brawl has a lot of upside, but 1 out of 3 times the Mountain Giant lives and you kind of just lose at that point. So.
But from what we've been seeing, Silent Storm kind of just loses this matchup, you know, 60, 70% of the time. It's very unfavored for him, especially at this stage of the game.
Yep.
So if he's playing to his outs, that Fiery War Axe is really going to need 6 damage to face, followed by a Disciple of C'Thun to the face, or a clutch Gore Howl draw. So he goes for the Brawl here, and the Barnes does end up living.
And he should not equip Fiery War Axe and hit that, in my opinion, for the reasons that you just said. He can just ghoul that out of the way next turn. Yeah. The one Argus that can buff the health up on that minion is gone already, so huge odds that remains 1 health on the next turn. He can clear that out of the way and just maximize his War Axe damage to face. I think Silent Storm is playing to his outs phenomenally well in this matchup. Still don't think it's going to be enough, but he's playing the matchup very, very well.
If Frozen picks up Reno Jackson at pretty much any point in this game, he will just shut it out. That Refreshment Vendor is no minimal amount of healing. I mean, 4 in this case, when he's only at 8, is very, very respectful. So instead, he decides to go with the Emperor Tharizan, discount that hand, essentially saying, you can't kill me from 8. I have a taunt minion up. I don't need to worry about playing super safe. I did that last turn. Yep. So instead, he's going to discount his entire hand and set him up for better future turns.
It just means that if he wants to, he can just straight up go to 15 next turn. If the board state was favorable for him, he can just start the Jiraxxus train rolling as early as turn 8. But now there is the matter of a 6-6 to deal with. This doesn't feel like a particularly secure Jiraxxus board state. He could potentially do Jiraxxus power overwhelming his 4-1, and that creates the dynamic of getting Jiraxxus down on an empty board, which is a great feeling for you for sure. Also, Silent Storm's list, unless I'm missing it, does not play Harrison Jones, so there is no consideration of giving your opponent too much value out of the Jiraxxus.
And Jiraxxus getting down as early as possible is always a good thing.
Love this play.
He's going to go for it. Like I was saying before, those Infernals can just shut down this match so quickly. And it's very difficult for the Warrior to deal 15 direct damage to face without the use of Grom Hellscreen. And the C'Thun just isn't high enough yet.
So Frozen is going to start putting the clock back on the Warrior now. He sees this as his window. He says, all right, I mean, you've put the pressure on me for a long, long time here, but now it is my turn. Now I'm going to put the clock back on you. I'm going to see what your answers are like. I don't want to take the back seat this whole game. This is what I built my deck to do, and we'll see how long Silent Storm can survive this onslaught of 6-6s or whether he can put together an aggressive push to try and race that 15 life.
You know, I always feel like when coming into this matchup as the Control Warrior, I'm like, I've got removal, I've got Brawl, I'm going to be okay. And then Jiraxxus just comes down. You can deal with the first couple of Infernals. And then from there on, it's just so futile. It just is terrible for the Warrior.
Certainly is. I mean, there's only 4 spot removal cards in the deck. You know, some people are like even going down to 1 execute these days. And, you know, every single time you press the hero power button, it's not a resource. It costs 2 mana. It's the only resource that it is. And it just requires an actual spot removal card from your opponent. I mean, you can't just sit there and wait for 4 or 5 of them to appear and then brawl them because you just die. It's 24 damage by the time they've got the 4th one on the board per turn. Like, it's just a ridiculous amount of pressure. And Control Warrior just doesn't live with it.
But here's the thing. Silent Storm is representing lethal right now because of the C'Thun in hand. We've seen C'Thun buffs from the Ancient Shieldbearer, meaning that it is at least a 10-10 worth of stats. And Frozen is only at 12 health. So by playing the Jiraxxus, he's always risking that C'Thun just coming down and dealing direct lethal if it is high enough.
Yep. But straight away, Frozen can just potentially lock all that out with a very defensive play right now. This 6-6 plus the can into Sun Fury Protector means that we are walled out. Frozen is going to choose to take the damage on his face here on the 3-3, which does open up some niche direct burst opportunities with the C'Thun. Should be relatively safe. That C'Thun is at a 10-10, as we suspect. And yeah, I mean, the wall is there already, right? I mean, Silent Storm's looking for Miracle World with this C'Thun if he plays it right now.
I mean, is Silent Storm's only chance to win 9 damage to face this turn? The longer he goes this game, the less likely it is becoming. Doomcaller Shield Slam there, I could have also seen. It would have given him a board presence, and it would have buffed that C'Thun even further. But he feels like he just needs to take the risk right now.
Well, here's the thing, and here's the line that I think Silent Storm sees. Like, it's easy to forget, he does have a 10-10 in play right now, right? Like, with that's a relevant factor. The 10-10 needs to be dealt with. If the 10-10 is dealt with by, say, this big game hunter that we're probably going to see come out, he does then have the Doomcaller in his hand, which can put it back into his deck and buff it up again. He then has Shield Block to potentially try and dig through his deck again. If he can draw his second C'Thun out again, maybe he sees that as his win condition, and that's the line that he's going to go for. But again, that is Dream Street at this point, and Frozen is probably just going to start to snowball from him.
Yeah, that's a great point, Sottle. Saving the Doomcaller here gives him chances for other, you know, obvious large C'Thun damage later on in the game. Yep. Had he played it before, then he might have tried to fight for board, but he wasn't going to win that battle. So in this case, he's going to have to get a little bit fortunate, but he can certainly do it. It's just going to be tough against this army of Infernals.
It sure is, and I think you have to play the Doomcaller this turn. You can tank this damage on board for one turn. Literally one turn only, but you can do it for one turn. You need to get that secondary win condition rolling with the additional C'Thun. Now, next turn, you'll be looking at a Brawl plus Shield Block turn to draw additional cards and clear away this board. Siphon Soul is a huge draw, by the way, for Frozen.
With Siphon Soul, I think it's just almost going to be locked out. If Silent Storm draws that second C'Thun, it will be a 12-12. The Doomcaller adds that 2-2 buff. But at 15 health and with an easy removal on the Doomcaller, it's going to be very difficult.
Yeah, going to assess his options here. Picks up a Soulfire, which means he's threatening to end the game very quickly. I think you just saw him do a quick scan of his damage on board there after he picked up the Soulfire. Doesn't have it this turn, but he is threatening it next turn. This will be a Desperation Brawl here from Silent Storm plus the shield block. But as you said, back up to 15 now is Frozen. So we are starting to see the plan come together. It's a long road yet. But as I said, those three wins on the board from Silent Storm mean next to nothing in the general sense of this series. He just has to win with this Warrior, and trial number one has been failed miserably by the Warrior deck.
This is just the weirdest position to be put in, to be perfectly honest. I mean, nobody wants to be reverse swept. Obviously, it's happened to all of us. It's never the best feeling. But to come into this tournament knowing that this is the only deck that is going to matter in the grand scheme of things, it's just bizarre.
Silent Storm went for a very niche win condition there. Didn't even go for the shield block line that I was suspecting. He actually tried to win the brawl with his own C'Thun's Chosen. Didn't pan out. That just left lethal on the board for Frozen. So this train of potentially never-ending C'Thun Warrior games will continue. The first test for the Warrior has been failed. The first test for Frozen's unique conquest strategy has been passed, but still a long road to go for both these players.
The train has officially left the station, and this Warlock deck could have been a little bit difficult with the wrong draws to pick up that win, so I'm glad he liked to get it out of the way very early on. As you said, the Hunter will likely just be a win against this deck, so sort of put one of the iffier decks in contention first, and he got a win with it, which means essentially, according to you, Sottl, that Priest is really the only one that is still a little bit up in the air.
Yeah, I mean, the mid-range Hunter, classically, even just a standard mid-range Hunter build, is already pushing 70% against Warriors anyway, just with like double high main, double Call of the Wild. When you suddenly slap an Azoth in there as well, then you are just increasing that number to ridiculous levels. The Paladin, you know, Justicar Trueheart has the potential to just beat Warrior on its own. It's just so much, you know, resource-free value in the Paladin deck that Warrior struggles to deal with. So the window was with, you know, the Reno Lock getting an unfortunate draw and pushing through, and of course the Priest deck that is now available. So I mean, I can't wait to see what's going to happen. This is one of the craziest series that I've had the pleasure to cast, one of the most unique series, and I can't wait to see how it goes from here.
I'm so excited. I just honestly, I want to see that Priest. I want to see that Paladin again. Such interesting decks, and here we go. It is going to be the Priest.
Okay, so there you see, number one, Sideshow Spelly, a Frozen Snap keeps Sideshow Spell Eater in his opening hand. He does not want to play this game with the Priest Hero power at all. He wants that juicy Warrior power. And remember, he doesn't have to steal Tank Up. Mm-hmm. He can steal Armor Up. He has his own Justicar in the deck that he can then upgrade that to Tank Up. So this is going to be bananas, but as I said, it's important that Silent Storm potentially has played against this specific Priest deck, that he's grabbed a friend, said, build this deck, play against me 100 times. I need to work out this matchup. My entire series is going to hinge on this matchup. Can I work it out? On turn two, Frozen's play. He hero powers and emotes. We are seeing it. The Priest we all know and love is coming out here in HCT.
But you know what, Sottl? His deck has no pathetic cards. It is very clutch in this matchup indeed. A hero power pass on turn three as well. I've never been so excited by a board filled with absolutely nothing.
I'm so pleased he actually emoted. Like, Frozen is now my new favorite player for actually just committing to the meme that turn. Thank you so much. You have made my tournament.
And he's made fans out of, I would assume, so many of the viewers out there. He's made a fan out of me. And actually, on turn four, Priest of the Feast.
Yep.
It's really good, and it challenges the Acolyte of Pain here.
And what's actually really important about Frozen's draw right now is he's got a very chunky minion-heavy draw. You know, his deck is minion light. It's most priest decks are. It's just kind of how they function. But he does have these Priests of the Feast. He does have the six drops that you see in his hand, and he does have Onyx Bishop. So it's important for him to build up a pool of these chunky mid-range minions so that he can potentially pressure the warrior with these, you know, Onyx Bishop plays in the late game, as well as being able to neutralize literally everything the warrior does with Entombs, Mind Controls, Shadow Word Deaths, Harrison Jones, Sideshow Spell Eater, Justicar Trick. What?
More than half of the list is just tiered especially for this. And there's literally only one minion in Frozen's deck that is below four mana. It is a single copy of Wild Pyromancer, which you usually see a snap two of in every priest deck because against other matchups, it's really good. Against the warrior, it's okay.
Yeah.
It's good enough to have one, but you literally just do not need to. Instead, we're seeing one copy of Bog Creeper in his list, which with the Onyx Bishop is really great.
Oh, babe, come on. Coin it out. I don't care if it's the right play. I just want to see it go now. It's definitely not the right play. Shield block here about is the right play here. Shield block execute even. Okay. Execute.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Execute is a little ambitious. There are some high value threats in this deck that need taken care of. Priest of the Feast isn't really one of them. I definitely think Silent Storm had the potential to chill there if you wanted to, especially since there are mind controls in the deck, right? Like, you can now lose to mind control if you start throwing out all your premium removal against these mid-range threats. Suddenly you can just get a Doomcaller mind controlled or a C'Thun mind controlled and you just kind of lose the game.
Yeah, but at the same time, most of Frozen's minions don't exceed 5 health. He actually only has one in the deck, the Bog Creeper, that does have the 8 health. So, I mean, can you really be worried about your own minions?
Yes! Like, there's two Entombs and two Mind Controls in this list.
Just a situation I'm sure Silent Storm is so not used to.
And this is what I keep coming back to. He has to be used to this situation. He has to have tested this matchup over and over again. If he's trying to play it like they're just a regular priest, he is going to lose.
I mean, it's turn 6. The warrior can play the Justicar, which challenges the Elise.
Contest the board.
It seems great. But Silent Storm knows there is one copy of Sideshow Spell Eater, which will just... Oh my god.
He also knows that his opponent has kept one card on the far left of his hand. Hero-powered and emoted on turn 2. Hero-powered on turn 3. So those cards are not early game plays. Another clue that they're not early game plays is that those cards aren't in the deck. There are no early game plays.
Yep.
So what is he going to keep in this matchup? He's going to keep Sideshow Spell Eater.
Turn 7.
Yep.
It's a hand full of utility.
Yep.
One minion that he could play this turn and literally just does not have to because it's much more useful in the late game. I wonder.
He's just going to heal up his Elise. This looks like potentially just a Holy Nova turn. Mm-hmm. He is able to deal with the C'Thun's Chosen here. And this is when I was just theory crafting this matchup. Like, how is this going to work? This was one of the win conditions I saw for the warrior, was just C'Thun's Chosen. Stick it to the board, beat him up, get him down to the, you know, the 15 to 20 health range just with a bit of minion pressure that they can't deal with, because 4-2 Divine Shield is a nightmare for Priest to deal with, and then finish them with C'Thun stuff. So now one C'Thun's Chosen has gone down. That is win condition number one potentially out the window for Silent Storm. Frozen will be checking that off the list. The C'Thun now is up to a 10-10 though, so there are some very strong cards active in the deck. Like, for example, Twin Emperor Veklor, which produces 2 4-6s on the board. Again, a nightmare for Priest to deal with.
Yeah, Twin Emperor and his twin Vecnalash would be very difficult for Frozen to deal with here, but he's saving cards like the Sylvanas, for instance, which do challenge that board very nicely. So, turn number 8. Okay.
Let's go. Let's just get it done.
And you know what? Silent Storm was, it looked like, avoiding playing the Justicar just a little bit. He had a couple of options where it would have been okay. It wasn't mandatory. So now Frozen just wants to start armoring up as fast as he can.
Yep. Interesting. He chose to go for the Power Word Shield play as opposed to just taking advantage of his freshly minted new hero power that actually does something. Priest players everywhere rejoice. But he chose to, you know, essentially just make a perfect Gorehowl target, which is kind of interesting. And now there was definitely a little game of chicken here between the two players, where Silent Storm, now having seen the Spell Eater come down, feels more happy about playing his own Justicar Trueheart. He can pair that with a Coin Shield Slam if he would like to as well to clear the board.
Maybe.
But now that the Sideshow Spell Eater is gone, he can play his Justicar, and he's saying to Frozen, well, now you need to get your Justicar.
Yes.
I'm not doing the work for you.
I mean, do you think that Frozen might have jumped the gun just a little bit here? It was definitely a strange game of chicken. But now a lot of his game plan is really riding on getting that Justicar for himself.
I think it was probably correct. He didn't want to play the Sylvanas there because he can pair Sylvanas and Shadow of Death himself to just steal a minion of his choosing. I think that makes a lot of sense. And just doing anything else really just felt like ceding pressure over to the Warrior.
Yeah.
He didn't really want to do that. So I think he just needed a 6-5 on the board right there. And of course, it does make his hero power better. The basic Warrior hero power is just better than the basic Priest hero power a lot of the time. So it is an improvement. Of course, he does still have that Justicar that he can dig to. But yeah, doesn't get the tank up that he would have liked. But at least Silent Storm showing some recognition of the matchup situation by at least having that little game of chicken going on in his head, right? He didn't want to give that tank up hero power over to the Spell Eater. And he's won at least that small exchange in the matchup.
Question is it going to be enough? So now Frozen has easier removals on both of these cards. The question is, how does he want to do it? And Tomb on the Sylvanas gives him a second Sylvanas in the deck. I really like this here. That Shadow Word Death can be used for the Doomcaller. I believe the second Entomb you really want to save for the C'Thun, because it means that Silent Storm will have only access to that single C'Thun.
Yeah, again, there's kind of an arms race situation. There was a turn where I, like an idiotic boob, suggested that he used Shield Slam instead of Execute, which is just hideously incorrect, because his plan here with the brand Doomcaller in his hand is probably to Shield Slam his own C'Thun just to get that done, make sure he can get two copies in his deck. No, he's abandoning that plan now. Just by playing the Doomcaller, he's just going for pressure with this 7-9. This is going to get met immediately by probably just a Mind Control. There it is. And now, suddenly, that's just a full swing on the board. This is what Mind Control does, ladies and gentlemen.
And I mean, it makes sense. Silent Storm had essentially two win conditions there. One, going for the extra C'Thuns in deck, and two, just trying to wrestle some board control and hit face as much as he possibly can. Gorehowl is 7 damage burst in this case.
Yep.
It's not terrible. So he went for the board control. Double Mind Control in the hand of Frozen did not work out. And now Silent Storm, how can he possibly win this game?
Just double Sylvanas in his hand. What is happening? Is this even Hearthstone? Why is Priest winning? I'm scared and confused, Cora.
I am so happy.
Okay.
Man, we have a whole range of emotions going on right now. This is awesome.
It is. No, I cannot dispute. This is fantastic from Frozen. And, you know, with this Priest deck working out so far, you know, the draw has lined up nicely for him. And way beyond that, you know, the deck building decisions from day one with this deck are phenomenal to be able to combat Warrior specifically. So he's being rewarded for his deck building in this series for sure. And he's now in a very, very solid looking position going forward. If he's able to seal this game, that puts him in a good spot for the series for sure, because the remaining decks are then the Warrior and the Paladin that I said cannot lose in this matchup.
And if that is the case, then Frozen may just be the most intelligent, you know, I don't even have words for it. Just a freaking genius. Like,
yeah.
Goodness gracious, if he manages to pull this off.
It's innovative, to say the least. It's risky, it's bold, it's brash, it's all kinds of things, but Frozen.
It's bold, it's brash, it belongs in the trash, but it is working here. It is working. It's a bit of a SpongeBob reference for anybody who caught that one.
Yeah, Gorehowl going to be able to take care of this Priest of the Feast here, and this could just start an inevitable decline for the Warrior in this matchup. He has also chosen to cycle his deck quite aggressively as well, so even Fatigue now as a win condition for Silent Storm is slipping away. Normally, the Warrior can get themselves into a favorable position in Fatigue, because Priest quite often spends time digging with powered shields, for example, looking for some proactive threats to play, and the Entombs don't bridge the gap enough to cover all the armor gain that Warrior picks up. But now Priest, you know, has the deck advantage, has a playable hero power in Fatigue that can actually match some of what the Warrior is doing, even though they haven't hit the Justicar yet. And Frozen is just looking in a very, very smooth sailing position here. Still with a Shadower, Death, a Sylvanas, and a Mind Control in hand to spare on top of Entomb number 2 that he's just picked up.
I mean, the only thing is, for the next couple of turns, he is really just going to be doing nothing. I mean, Soundstorm's not putting on enough pressure,
there
but that
go.
Twin Emperor Veklor is a card that can start to do it.
Yeah. And now Silent Storm has a decision, because now he's lost the Doomcaller plan. I don't think the Ancient Shieldbearer gain 20 plan is really going to get him anywhere. So is the best use for the brand now just to get an extra 4/6 out of the Twin Emperor Veklor and try and push for board that way?
I mean, I can't really see it not being at this point. Frozen does have Arcanine Circle. We see them both in hand. That deals 4, but he doesn't have the Priest Hero power to clean up one of the 4/6s like usual.
Right.
And without an Excavated Evil in hand, it looks like these Veklors will be unchallenged somewhat. There is that Sylvanas as well. I mean, Frozen just has so many options. Like, it's hard to see Silent Storm getting in any sort of a favorable position, but I think Bran Emperor Veklor is the way he would do it.
I mean, Orcanite double circle or Orcanite circle plus another AoE will be the things that he's worried about. There are 3 AoEs in this deck. Holy Nova, Excavated Evil, Excavated Evil. He's already seen 1 Excavated used, 1 Holy Nova used. So the range of options that kill these Veklors are pretty low. He has chosen to go for the play here. Frozen does have a pretty tidy clear with the circle and the flash heal at least, but does just stop a little bit short because of the lack of Priest Hero power here. Meaning there will be a little bit of damage retained on the board. Nothing else in his hand that can interact with these 4/2s.
But picking up that Bog Creeper is, I would say, pretty good. We haven't seen either Onyx Bishop as of yet. All right, so Silent Storm committed to the board win condition.
He just has to go. He has a hard read from his opponent's hand. Excavated Evil number 2 is not there.
Yes.
It is not in the hand. He has to go now. This is his window. This is his last stand, his final push, his last hurrah. If this board state gets dealt with, Silent Storm has nothing left, but this is the correct line for sure. He's finding himself a win condition again in this series now.
He's got this board state, a 6 damage Gore Howl, and an 18-18 C'Thun in deck that if he picks it up, could win him this game. Now, Frozen is in somehow a position where he is behind. He needs to draw that AoE removal. The Circle of Healing will not be able to remove this because he just used that Arcanine.
I'm wondering whether Silent Storm is actually legitimately considering hitting face with Gore Howl this turn, which is his only decision, or whether he's just trying to send some sort of bluff about the contents of his hand. Harrison Jones, of course, answering my question straight away. That was the consideration as to whether he plays around that card specifically. He chose not to, and then the Fate of Hearthstone immediately chose to punish him, but that is an 18-18 C'Thun!
Oh my goodness. All right, 4, 8, 12, 14 on board, plus the 18. It's not enough. Silent Storm is 2 damage off of lethal, but Frozen. Oh my god. Okay, so Bog Creeper, you can death the C'Thun.
Onyx Bishop can get you Priest of the Feast, which can heal you as well. I don't see it. I don't think it's there.
I don't think he can win.
I think the master plan has failed, ladies and gentlemen.
Unbelievable. He was in such a dominant position. He had answers for literal days. Or as long as this matchup went, at least. And now Silent Storm's literal Hail Mary is going to pay off.
But like, this is how exposed Priest as a class can be. The situation looks so comfortable. I was calling that perhaps Frozen was in a favored position in the series as a whole. But something as simple as one board push that the Priest missed the answer to, and this crazy, commendable, insane strategy from Frozen has fallen down at hurdle number 1. Well played to Silent Storm. He recognized the niches of that matchup very, very well, and he is going to be progressing through to our semifinals.
Absolutely incredible play there from both guys. We were saying Frozen came in with a crazy strategy, but Silent Storm is no pushover of a player by any means, and he is the 3rd player going through to the semifinals. Just incredible.
I mean, If Priest cannot win in that form, in that matchup, like if that's what it takes for us to see some Priest in tournament format, and it still fell short of it, Blizzard, please, come on.
It's in a bad place, yeah. But the Tyrande hero portrait looks really, really it's nice. Beautiful. It looks really good. All right, let's go ahead and throw it over to the side table where TJ and Frodan are going to break down that match.